So thank you everyone for joining us on this Cloud Native Islamabad webinar. And today we're talking about the virtual cluster, like why we need it, what is the use cases behind it, and ultimately we want to know the power of virtual cluster. So thank you everyone who hop into this channel. I'm your host, moderator for today's session. My name is Saim Safdar. I'm a co-founder of Cloud Native Islamabad community. And today I am joined by Engin, Diri. Thank you very much, Engin, for joining me today. How are you? Introduce yourself to my audience.
Yes, of course. So hey, everybody. My name is Engin Diri, and I'm working at the Schwarz Group in Germany. And I'm really excited, as you can see, being live in a session is always some exciting thing. So I want to talk about how we use vCluster in our company, and I want to share this with you, and I hope everybody enjoys this. And if you have any questions, feel free to contact in the chat, and I'll try to answer it the best possible.
Yes, absolutely. So you will just try to share your screen. So yeah. I will go back and managing those things in the background. And now it's your time, and people who are hopping to this channel, show your interest, share your question, what you want to do. And if you have more questions after the webinar end, you just ask on the Twitter. We will love to get your answer covered. And if you can join us on the Cloud Native Islamabad Discord server as well. So today is this 1 hour is for you, and Engin did prepare a wonderful session. He's been a wonderful speaker in the Cloud Native community. And if you follow him, he's actually a learning resource for you as well. So you just share your screen. So
okay. Thanks a lot. I'm one of the guys who did not manage to buy a screen since the pandemic. So I have only my laptop since 2 years. So not wondering if you see now my whole desktop. So let me start the presentation. Today's topic I want to talk about is how we going to build, I called it now, vending machine, to say how we have the possibility as user from a service to say, I want to create a cluster. We know that we have different possibilities with cloud providers to say, okay, I can go to a cloud provider, I can provision via Terraform and Pulumi, I can directly provision a cluster for myself, and then I can work with it here. With the nice folks from Loft, we have a new technology called vCluster. We can say we have one Kubernetes cluster underneath this, and then we can, like a vending machine, we can ask for virtual clusters. And this is something I want to show you to say, okay, not only the way you would do it with a CLI approach, but to say how we can embed it more in a process you would see, for example, in your company, or you would agree with your operating team or in your cross-functional team to say, is there a way to get virtual clusters? Okay, just shortly, as I said, my name is Engin. I put all my social stuff. So if you want to see some pics of me, please follow me on Instagram. And of course, I'm also tweeting on Twitter. I'm working since 2017. I'm working for the Schwarz Group. Just shortly for the Schwarz Group, we are behind the brands Lidl and Kaufland. So if anybody visit Europe or lives in Europe, probably know us. We are the fifth biggest retailer in the world. And the Schwarz Group as a name is behind this. And I'm working in the Schwarz IT. This is the IT provider for the whole Schwarz Group. So mainly I'm doing cloud transformation and cloud enablement. I'm working in a more cross-functional role. I visit different projects and help them either with active involvement or with some consulting to help them to gain speed or to solve a particular problem. So that's really, really interesting. And yeah, my motto is continuous everything, like everybody at the moment. So that's really, really good to see. Okay, so just shortly for my agenda, because here's now two parts very important to understand. And I'm always I'm really, really advocating to say we need to understand some of the basic concepts to have a big, to have the understanding of the big picture, to say, okay, let us deep dive into two of the main parts of this implementation. So one part is, I just want to give you a short introduction of GitOps, the way we define GitOps. So later when we see the code and we see the things moving, we have this aha effect to say, ah, okay, that's what he meant when he talked about GitOps. So this is one part. And then I want to go quickly over the theory behind vCluster. The good part is, especially for me, I'm also more a development person, so I'm more a consumer, to say, for a person who just needs to consume the service, it's very easy to understand. And if you have some basic understandings of Kubernetes, for example, you will see the similarity of some of the concepts vCluster is implementing, and you say, okay, that sounds very familiar, and yeah, actually it's not that complicated. So really, really interesting stuff. Then we will go to the moving stuff to see the demo. I will go and I will spend a certain amount of time, a larger amount of time on the demo. And then we can wrap up and say, okay, what's the conclusion? And maybe you already have some interesting questions we can discuss about this. So GitOps, it's a really a broad word, and you will see different approaches, and people all the time have also different understandings from GitOps. In this term, when we talk about GitOps, we mean now the GitOps in the Kubernetes way, to say, okay, yeah, saving, for example, your declarative files or your Terraform files or whatever in your Git repository, it's already GitOps, yes, of course. But there's also a certain specification from the working group, from the GitOps working group, to say, okay, some of the pillars define GitOps with the Kubernetes in background. So one of the important parts when we talk about GitOps in the Kubernetes way is to say, okay, our entire system is described declaratively. So everything, we have everything written in YAML, for example, it's completely clear that the state we're going to submit to the compute, for example, is completely declarative. And you can instantly see, okay, this is the situation I have on my cluster, and can keep comparing with the state on the cluster. And now I already said this, the desired system state, so the thing I describe, if I say I want to have a deployment with a replica set of one, is checked in a version control system. So most of the time, as the name suggests, we're talking about Git. So that's the obvious part. It could be another version control system if you still work, for example, with SVN or something. I never tried it with SVN, so I don't know if it's working, but at the end, it should be just version control. So that's the important part. The desired system state should be in a version. Any changes gets automatically applied to the system. So, and that's the really interesting part. And you will see later also in the demo how how we implemented this whole approved changes part. But it's very important to say, okay, if I'm approving it, be it a pull request, be it a Git commit, because I have the elevated rights to push into the branch, into the main branch, for example, that means it's approved in some kind of way. Maybe it's for us, for example, the Schwarz group, it's very important also for the governmental requirements to say, okay, we can audit who approved what and what kind of changes happened. That's very important. So that's the thing. But there is a process before, and if it gets approved, it gets into the final state and it gets applied to the system. And then the other part for the GitOps in the Kubernetes world is there is an agent running, and the agent keeps on reconciling the system, keeps on checking the system. So now the agent is running on Kubernetes, for example, Flux or Argo CD or whatever, is in the system installed, and he keeps on checking in a defined interval to say, okay, how is the state in the actual, in my Kubernetes cluster? And looks up and says, what should it be in, what did you describe in your Git system? So, hey, there's written replica one. So some person logged into the system, some operators, some developers, and they manually changed something, gave it more memory, more whatever. And the system is like, whoa, there's an error. So, or there's a difference. So there comes the fine tuning of the agent. So you could set the agent to give you an alert. So you get via your alerting system, you say, hey, there is a difference. What should I do? Somebody changed, so the state is not the same anymore. Some system can auto enable, for example, a self-healing process, means he will reconcile it back to the state in the Git system. Because as you said, the system is the desired system state is checked in a version system. So the single point of truth is the Git repository. And then you can, depending on your maturity level, depending on your processes in the company, you can then decide with your operating team or with your team to say, auto reconcile, auto prune, auto clean, whatever we want to do to keep the system in sync with the declarative state and the state on the Kubernetes cluster. So this is a short introduction to the whole GitOps part, and I'm sure everybody heard of what is, and it plays a major role now in the implementation later on. And now we come to the vCluster part. So vCluster is a project from the people of Loft, like Siam also introduced, and I probably you heard about this or you're very interested in this. As we said in the beginning, you can create virtual cluster, and there are some basic concepts would make sense to talk about and to say, okay, some of the patterns they are using. So we have one part, we have the whole control plane. So this is the one where who takes care, who do the control management, who contains also the API server, so similar to the underlying Kubernetes. And then you have this another component called the syncer, who's actually taking care of the communication. So he's actually some kind of a scheduler, and he takes care if some commands come to schedule the commands to the virtual cluster for creating a pod or whatever to the underlying cluster. So he starts actually the pods in the underlying cluster. So that's a really, really powerful component in the vCluster, and we will see this also later in detail, especially in the deployment part, how the syncer is connected here. But these are the two components, as you see, which are very interesting in the vCluster part. And now comes also some of the design principles, what the people behind vCluster thought about, why we should use, for example, vCluster. And I found them really, really good, and I wanted to share them also with you. So one of the things what also for us was very appealing was this lightweight approach to say, okay, it's really not that difficult to install a vCluster, to run vCluster, for example. That's really, really a nice effect we have here. It doesn't give you additional pressure for the operating team, for example, which is very important. So imagine you have still a platform team, platform engineers who are taking care, for example, of the Kubernetes cluster or an SRE team or whatever your organizational structure is, or even you build it, you run it approach, where in a cross-functional team, you're also responsible for your compute. It doesn't give you additional pressure and you can handle it, what is very, very interesting. It has no impact on the performance because, as I said before, with the syncer approach of vCluster, he schedules our workload as a pod on the underlying host. So there is just as executing your workload. This is also very, very nice approach. The reduce of requests on the host cluster is also very interesting. And this is actually something we saw also in our workplace. I mean, we run in our on-premise infrastructure, we run actually 4 to 5 OpenShift cluster. And OpenShift, for example, they have the approach of doing a multi-tenancy via the namespace separation. And as you can imagine, if you have plenty of persons, plenty of projects, plenty of operators and all the stuff, keeps on submitting requests to the API server, there is really, really much going on our host clusters, for example. And we already see this, for example, that we most of the time we get throttling warnings when we kubectl apply, for example, and we see there's much going on, and the control plane needs to be much more monitored and much more taking care that everything is working, because there's so much load on the system on the single point. That's what something I really was a fan of it. It's just the easy provisioning. I mean, honestly, when we show later the demo, I'm sure that that most of the people are like, that's not difficult. And wow, I expected some rocket science, but that's the good part. It's not, it's really very, very easy to provisioning. And even the approach I choose now, it's very easy. It's nearly as easy as you would do it with a CLI approach, for example. What's always good for the security for InfoSec also in the company, if we introduce, for example, new software and so on, is to say, okay, we don't need any admin privileges. So we can run this as a normal not admin user, for example. This is also very, very useful, for example, if you want to run it in a more more regulated cluster, for example, where the SRE team takes really care that nobody can just like this start everything with admin rights or with leveraged privilege. So this is also very, very friendly to go align with your compliance or with your security requirements on your cluster. And yes, of course, we have here the single namespace encapsulation. That means we give a cluster, we give a namespace, and inside this namespace on the host cluster, the whole, let us say, vCluster gets spawned. So we have here only this approach. That's also very, very nice. As I said to you with OpenShift, when we have the whole multi-tenancy over namespaces is really, really gets difficult. And another part is it's the easy cleanup. So if we don't need this, we can just get rid of it very quickly. And this is also something which makes vCluster as a use case also very interesting. For example, if you want to use vCluster in a CI environment to say, okay, I want to start it via a vCluster, for example. So it's very good. You can delete everything quite quick. Okay, just on a graphical side, so what we said, we have underneath, we have our host cluster. In the host cluster, we have our vCluster control plane, and then we have the so-called host namespaces. Let me see if I can show a laser pointer or something like this. Yeah, so that's the control plane. Again, that's the reason we talked about this, the components. So we can now identify the components again. We see, okay, the control plane is installed. And then we have the so-called host namespaces where we say, okay, here we have, for example, the for a specific team or whatever you want to organize, the cluster name and so on gets assigned. And on top of it, we have now the syncer, what we said also before, that now the syncer gets also in the place. And now we see here the actual namespaces of the vCluster where we schedule the work. So when we see, for example, we deploy now the pod one or we deploy the service, whatever, it gets, here the arrows are missing. So you have to see the picture. And now the stuff gets scheduled on our host cluster system. It gets a special annotation with the name here, so you will see that the pod who gets scheduled on our host cluster has a specific naming convention built together with the namespace and also the resource name. And inside here, it's the namespace in your vCluster, and the syncer takes care to schedule the actual Kubernetes workload on the host cluster. So as we said before, very, very easy to understand, and but still so powerful. I mean, that's really the interesting part here. Okay, then without any further ado, let us go to our demo. So I will close this one. Okay, so now we are here in the demo part, and now I will try to resize everything. So what I did, for example, I went through our POC we do currently in our workplace to evaluate vCluster as a solution. I tried to rip out as much of the specifica we have at our work to give you a good understanding of the way we want to implement vCluster in our project. So we have, first of all, we have the whole infrastructure part. So what I did, for example, here too, and we go into detail also in this, is I created a Kubernetes cluster. And I do everything, for example, in this demo, I use Pulumi, for example. You could use Terraform, or maybe you get your cluster already provided from a different team. So here in this case, I did everything on myself. So with Pulumi, I created, let me go here. So I went to Scaleway. So my Kubernetes cluster is running on Scaleway, and I created a fairly one node cluster for this demonstration. That's completely fine. So I can set up my Kubernetes cluster. I created everything necessary. That could be also depending on the cloud provider you're using or your on-premise structure, it could be different. Setting up some auto upgrade and some admission plugins, whatever you need. Finally, I created also the Kubernetes node pool for this cluster. In this case, I choose an L cluster that's 4 CPUs and 8 gigabyte of RAM, which is enough for the demonstration. The interesting part is here also what we have is that we enabled auto-scaling. So from in most of the time, my cluster is running only with one node pool. And if I have more load or more teams or whatever we are going to do, he will automatically provision additional nodes. And if the load goes down, maybe the projects are stopped, or maybe we don't need any more additional vCluster, the Kubernetes cluster is completely scaling automatically back again to the minimum node size I gave. That's really good. So we have this kind of elasticity, what we need from the from different cloud providers. And we can fairly quick spin up new instances, new node pools, because we have some workload we want to schedule and we don't have the place anymore on our Kubernetes cluster. So that's a really good part. And if you would, for example, use vCluster on a Google Autopilot, for example, you even don't need to care about this stuff anymore. So it will be also abstracted away from you from the service provider, in this case, Google, for example. So that's one part. And now we come to an interesting part, because now we want to, we have here at, until now, here everything gets provisioned and our system is up and running. And we will see this now if we, no, that's the wrong picture. Okay, so we can go now to Scaleway. And let me, I applied everything with Pulumi up, and I think that's now the provisioning of the infrastructure is not in scope now for this webinar, but we can see here the cluster was created here, and I have here my pool, everything what I defined. You see the settings are all in. We can see the nodes, and we get all the additional information. That's completely fine. That's what we wanted. And completely fine. So here in this case, the cluster is up and running. And now comes one of the things, because as we said in the beginning, we want to have everything in a GitOps approach. So here we say, okay, the whole declaration is everything. It's inside a Git repository. There's nothing applied by hand. And we want that everything, if something happens or we need to create an additional cluster, we want to go, for example, a prod environment or whatever, we can just spin up the Pulumi with a different stage. We can say now we want, here in this case, I'm working with the dev stage. I could say I want to create a prod stage, and the code is will be the same. I just change, for example, some of the properties, and I can spin it up again. If I want to change something, I create a pull request, I commit this stuff, people can review it and say, okay, it makes sense if we want to increase, for example, the size now to 6. No, that's really fine. But because we want to run everything on a code side, some of the initial applications I wanted to pre-install so we can start with the whole story. And this is an interesting approach, and you can probably, there are different approaches here. So first one approach is I want to subscribe my DNS alias, I want to subscribe to the public IP address I get from my Kubernetes load balancer. So there's a project called external DNS, and to run external DNS, I need to provide my my Scaleway credentials. So that's one thing I say. Okay, I don't want to go to the machine. I don't want to write a kubectl apply or something like this. I want to execute a pipeline, and it should do this if it's queue, if it's whatever, if the password is changing. I just want to go to my vaulting system or to my secret store. I want to change the access key or the secret key, and then I just reapply the Pulumi script or the Terraform script. So this is the part here. It's creating the namespace for external DNS, and it's applying at the moment only the secret, because what we learn from GitOps is you cannot commit your passwords into the Git system, at least not in a human readable form. So that's the thing. Here, I'm using the vault system from Pulumi to encrypt all my passwords. So the passwords are all encrypted and you cannot read them if you have access to the code base, for example. And I don't need to come up maybe with a system parallel. I don't need to build a HashiCorp vault, for example. Maybe I don't have it at the moment. Maybe I want to run the HashiCorp vault on this Kubernetes cluster. So we come in this chicken and egg situation. And here I use a Pulumi to take care of my password here. I provide the namespace and the password. That's one part. So that's the thing he installed here with the external DNS. So external DNS, the application itself, it's not installed at the moment. And now I create the Argo CD. I'm going to use Argo CD as a GitOps engine or the whole platform. And here there's also some specifica. Yes, we create the namespace. That's completely fine. And now we apply the Helm chart. But here, when we see the Helm chart, it's really the bare minimum. So I really installed and configured. There is no service monitor. There's no TLS encrypted ingress or whatever. It's really the bare minimum because I want to deploy all my applications via GitOps, via the whole GitOps approach. I don't want to write this all down here and so on. I said, okay, I want to use Argo CD to deploy the applications we will need to run the whole cluster. So what I did now here is it's just the minimum to get Argo CD started, and we can then apply our whole application stack to it. So as you can see, it's really the bare minimum. I prepared some stuff for the external DNS and so on. I said, okay, please use Argo CD and please create an ingress for me. It should not be with TLS and so on. It's not necessary at the moment because I don't have the cert manager installed. So that's one thing. And then we see our pipeline. So what we can see now is we created in our task file pipeline. That's another, it's a similar like a make file. I created the description to say, okay, please, if I type task infrastructure, please start my Pulumi infrastructure and please export the kubeconfig temporarily in my system. And that's all. And now when this is finished, I can go on in my pipeline. I can say, okay, and this is the bootstrapping pipeline to get this this host cluster up and running. And now I say to him, and then when you are finished and the Kubernetes is up and running and the Argo CD is also up and running, now please apply all the applications to the cluster. So let me go here. So if we go to Excalidraw, so what did we achieve? So that's very, very important. So that's our Scaleway cluster. Okay, the Scaleway cluster is executed. Here we have our bootstrap script, could be Terraform, could be whatever. So bootstrap script. Okay. And here we have our Git repository. Okay. So all the application definition we will see later on what we need, for example, cert manager. Ah, come on. So the cert manager. And So we put this here, or the ingress. We need, in any case, we need an ingress controller and so on. Everything is written in my Git repository. And the Bootstrap cluster, what he did, he, the first step he went, we go to the Scaleway API of our cloud provider and say, hey, please, can you create me a Kubernetes cluster? So he created the Kubernetes cluster. And when it's done, the second step we're going to do, we say, hey, please apply all the Argo CD, because what we saw just a second before, we saw we have a really minimum Argo CD up and running, enough to deploy the applications, because it's automated. We don't need to, we don't need a UI and so on. We can see everything if we need it, for example, with the kubeconfig stuff. But in this case, Argo CD is running. We say to our Bootstrap script, we say, hey, please apply the application to Argo CD. And what Argo CD is then doing, he will deploy the description of the applications we described in our Git repository. He will deploy the application on its own into the cluster, create a namespace, create the pods and so on. And that's really nice. So we achieved a full circle. We have everything highly automated. We have zero involvement. In the happy case, of course, we have zero involvement for any human interaction. And now there's the interesting part, which is very important. This is a blueprint. So with just extending, changing the configurations, I mean, we can change now some of the configuration parameters. We can take it. So let me take this here and say, okay, I need a second cluster identically built with the settings. And I just can call this now, and this is now my dev cluster. I mean, some companies, and we also have different clusters for different stages. So now I could create a prod cluster also and say, okay, this is here. And here in this cluster, maybe the nodes are not this big or something like this. And on my prod cluster, maybe I have a GPU underneath it and so on. But the idea behind this, that this Bootstrap script is always the same and can be executed in the similar way with just changing some of the configuration. So if we go back, and this is now what happened, we applied our infrastructure. This was this part. We applied the minimum Argo CD, and we tell now with applying the application, we tell now Argo CD, and this is your applications you're going to need, you need to execute. And for this, I created this application folder inside the same Git repository. You can argue, you can say, hey, can we separate this? Can I put the infrastructure in one place? Maybe there are different persons and so on. Or I don't want that people see whatever, change everything code. That's really up again to the company philosophy and the way you are working. I put here now for the demo purpose, I put the application folder into the same Git repository. And as you can see now, here becomes now interesting. These are now all the applications we need for the actual cluster. So if I want to access, for example, via my domain, I need an ingress controller. So I created an ingress application of the type Argo CD, as you see. And I define here, this is a Helm chart. I say which version he should use. And I created some of the values. And now you can see I also started now to enable, for example, the service monitor. The service monitor is a resource coming from the Kube Prometheus stack. And that's now the interesting part. Now I can deploy the application one by one. I can put them into a specific order using, for example, this Syncwave approach to say, please first deploy the Kubernetes Prometheus stack, because there is something inside we need for the other stuff. So that's really fine. I used to glue all the applications together. I used Customize. I mean, Customize is also a nice tool. It's something similar to Helm, for example. So you can create deployments and can patch properties and so on. I'm sure Simon will do also, or has already, a video also about this to talk about Helm and Customize in more detail. I use Customize to bundle everything together. So Customize is for me my container. I create the description here. I say, hey, this is now the whole application deployment. The application deployment belongs from following subcomponents. As you can see now, I deploy Engine X. I deploy external DNS to get my IP address and my alias. I deploy the cert manager because I want the TLS. I deploy Prometheus. And now comes the interesting part. I deploy Argo CD again. So I use Argo CD to manage Argo CD, which is also really nice. And as you see now here, there's much more properties. Before, less properties, no certificates, nothing. It was just the naked Argo CD. And now I deploy it again and say to him, and now you get the full-blown installation with everything you need. I mean, I could even come up now with some OIDC provider because I don't want to use username and password and so on. This is completely up to you. Maybe you have an internal OIDC provider, maybe use OAuth or Okta or whatever. It's completely up to you. But the idea behind this now, we roll out the infrastructure with Terraform or Pulumi, in my case with Pulumi. We install the minimum engine to say, hey, and now fetch the real deal from the Git repository. We describe everything here. So now we can make pull requests. If there's a new version or whatever, I can go, I can just change the YAML stuff. And the system, that's what we talk with the GitOps, is auto-reconciling because now he checks the Git repository and we go into the definition and checks the Git repository and says, okay, there's a change. I need to reapply the stuff now again. So let us see how this is going to look like if we apply everything. So we get the SSL because I use Let's Encrypt with the production with the staging environment and not with the with the productive thing, because sometimes if you make some wrong requests, you get banned for a certain time with the domain. I did not want to make the risk. But as you see, it's the one from Let's Encrypt. You can change this. We can show this also here in the cert manager. When we go to the cluster issuer here, you can change the server, the ECMI endpoint. You can change to the productive environment. It's completely fine. Could be useful example for your dev cluster to say, okay, here, I don't care it, if it's a cell. I mean, not a valid certificate here in this case. But as you see, if everything gets deployed, this is the application stack which gets deployed. Everything in green. We can go now into every stage here. And we see that everything is deployed. Everything is in sync. And that's what it's supposed to look like. So that's really, really fine. I can quickly... this is now the whole Prometheus stack, for example, and the whole Grafana. So if we, for example, go now to our alert manager. Let me see that. And here's the alert manager. So everything, the alert manager is up and running. And now to show you how I set up the deployment, you see, I say to him, please make a self heal. If somebody is something changing, please reconcile the stuff. That's very interesting. So if we go to alert manager, and I will delete now the alert manager, the pod, I hope the Temu gods are with me, and he should reapply it instantly. You see, he instantly started the pod again for me because he's reconciling, and then the system is like, oh no, there's something wrong. I will reconcile it. So I even don't have the chance to change anything, and my system is back again. So that's really, really nice. That's the one part. I already have also the Grafana up and running. So we can here see now our Grafana. We can go now to different metrics boards and see how our cluster is behaving. So let me look for the let me just get the cluster networking. That's completely fine. So Prometheus is up and running and already pumps out much of the data I need for my operation part. And this is all applied via GitOps. That's really part. So Now we managed our cluster is up and running and I installed all the tools I need. I mean, you could now come up with some vulnerability check. You can come up with a policy as code and so on. So you can create everything fine and neat here in this approach. And this is actually what we all do also in our clusters in our company. So we define all these applications or services, you can call them what you want, all in GitOps. So the SRE team can go in and can change the stuff there. And now we come to the part, how does vCluster works here? So how are we going to install vCluster? vCluster has two different approaches to work with. We can use the CLI approach and say, okay, we download the vCluster CLI and type vCluster create cluster, and I give some properties inside. But this is not something we can use GitOps, for example. This, we can create pipelines. No, nothing wrong on this. I mean, I can create a pipeline, I can check it into Git, I can, everybody is visible, that's completely fine. But we said we want to use the creation of a vCluster also via the GitOps approach. So I create a pull request. So here we come back now to the vending machine to say, I go to my repository. It could be again, it could be the same, it could be a different. I go to the vCluster, to the specific folder, whatever is the regulation you have inside your team. And I can create now a pull request and can define now the needs of my cluster. Here in this example, I come up with some fantasy ideas. So what I did now is I say to my application, I said, hey, please, application stack, install vCluster for me. And as you can see now, vCluster is again an application from Argo. In this case, we are not using a Helm chart. We say to vCluster, please go to the repository, in my case, vCluster webinar, under the path vCluster, it could be root if you have a separate thing. This is the specific revision. So for example, main, if you work with a pull request flow to say, okay, everything on main gets also delivered to production or whatever. So I define the application here and I say to him, please go to this repository and look up there. So this approach you see here called in Argo CD is called app of apps pattern. So we created an application which itself has applications of the type Argo CD. How does it look like? That's very interesting also to see. So we go back to our cluster. Let us ignore the first one here. And this is now the interesting part. You see, we have now this vCluster application, which itself has applications of the type, of the application. And this, as we saw now, let us see the details. The system is, as you can see, going to the Git repository of mine, going to the path and looking there for some descriptions, what's going on. And here I use customize again. That's also, I use customize here to glue, as we did in the application, to glue now the different cluster definitions together and say, here is everything you need to apply it to the cluster. In my case, I come now up to say, okay, we have the webshop department. The webshop department, we are now in a microservice environment or whatever environment, and they have actually two teams. And both teams, they want their own vCluster. They want to work maybe in the development environment. They want to destroy the stuff. They want to recreate the stuff. So they can come here and define everything, as you can see. Again, an Argo application. They can come up here with some labels. This is some labels you can check, for example, with your policy as code rule. You can say, okay, everything has to be labeled. So I know when something gets broke down, the SRE team, for example, can contact somebody from the team. They know the department, they know which project, for example. So that's really neat, and they can take care that everything is also labeled in terms of alerting or whatever happens. And we can come up now with some information. So for example, in my case, I want that I can access my cluster via an ingress. So it's not something like forwarding of a service, for example, on my local machine to create kubectl proxy forward or something like this. I create an ingress resource. I also use external DNS to subscribe my DNS so I get a valid IP address. And that's some part. Interesting is just to mention one thing. At the moment, you have to provide the service CIDR number, the range of IP addresses from your service, you have to provide by hand. This is also in the documentation when you use the Helm approach. So there are different ways to get this. I created here a little test. So you have to, you can just create an wrong service and he give you an error message with the correct service CIDR. This is just one thing to keep in mind. I mean, it's in the documentation, it's clear, and I hope the people at Loft, they will find a different approach to change this, maybe that we don't need to know this, because as you see in my case, I had to do some tricks to get the address. Maybe different cloud providers will show you instantly, for example, in AWS, you will get this information. So maybe more obvious here in my approach, I had to do this this little tweak. And then of course, I used the properties of the Zynker. We saw Zynker, one of the components. And I said to him, hey, please add the URL team-1 ediri.cloud, please add them to the Sun, so my certificate is not crying and saying, hey, the certificate is not valid because it has to be an IP address or something like this. So that's really, really fine. I leveraged some of the resources. So that was only to show that you can also give you more rights if you want. Per default, this is all on false. So as we said before, with the design principles, you don't need this stuff. Okay. And then when everything works fine and I created this both here, you see I have team one and team two, and they are completely in sync. Everything gets deployed on my cluster. You see he created everything what is necessary. So now let us create a team to see the things moving. So now we understand the some of the things, it's working, and let us see how it could look like to create an Kubernetes cluster the GitOps way. So we check out the Git repository. I just take care that I completely rebased everything, so everything's up to date. So now we come up with a team name. So let us say we are now in the shop. We create now a shop backend. Maybe we have already a shop backend. So let us let us take, we are from the web shop. We are the web shop backend team, and we want to create a backend service. Again, the folders are completely up to you. And I will copy paste this to make it quicker. So now we create a team three. We say we have now an additional team. So let me change the stuff here. So now we are the backend team. Development team, that's completely fine. And let me change the parts here where. So now I created my definition. Again, in the documentation, you can change the things you need. Maybe you want also a specific Kubernetes K3S version. You can change this according to your needs and so on. That's completely fine. I completely agree with it. And what I want now is to say, please deploy this automatically for me. So I just glue it now together. I say, hey, in the web shop backend, there is now a single team. I could create also a customized file there to glue them together here, so I don't have a huge list here. It's really here in this case, it doesn't matter because we have only one cluster here. So team, let me see that I don't have team one written. Yeah, that's completely fine. So I changed everything to team three. Let me just counter check. So, okay. Now I can say add team three. There's a special thing. So I just say commit. Then let me push the stuff. So I can now create a feature request. I could say we have a new team. Maybe there's a specific pattern. I just say new team. So, and let me go now to GitHub. So we go to our GitHub repository and we see we have now a pull request. That's completely fine. It could be a different system on your side. It doesn't need to be GitHub. I can create now my pull request, and now I have reviewers, people who can look on it and can say, okay, I can run also some pipelines on it because there is some validation needs to be done and so on. I can say, okay, that's fine, I'm agree, or do you really need this version? Maybe we should use a different version. We are now in a collaborative state, which is really, really nice. In my point, that's completely fine. I want to execute this now on my main branch. And now we have to think again, going back to our view. We defined the vCluster here with app details. We said, please look for changes in this Git repository in this main branch. And now the story starts again. We merge now the branch into the main branch. We have changes inside. And what we would expect now, so the changes are applied, we would now expect that the system detects that there are changes and will auto reconcile these changes. So take some seconds, so it's not instant and so on, because he's not polling every time. So you can also change the polling. I will now, not to break the story, just to show you, to speed up the stuff, I will now click. Oh, no, I don't need it. I did not click. So you see, he detected changes. He detected that there's now a new team. He automatically created the team 3. I didn't click on anything. So now I would expect that the team 3 is here. So that's completely fine. And he should normally, okay, I did not enable here autosync here. Maybe I had it to write autosync. So now I need to click on this, but I don't want to click on it, but okay. We have not much time left anymore. So in this case, I will just click by hand. And now everything gets deployed for me. I don't need to take care of this. So let us see that the pod is there. Okay, the pod is also executed. That's completely fine. Let us see that the pod gets also in a healthy state, that we actually can try now to schedule something on it. So pod, wow, that's also very, very nice. Let us take a quick look on our dashboard. We go to namespaces, we choose the namespace 3, and let us see when he starts to scrape. And now here you see the monitoring also kicks in. So he detected that there is some workload now. The stateful set is started. So we have it also in our monitoring system. That's really nice. And now we can say, hey, I'm the team. I want to start to work now. So what I'm going to do now is I want to provide the people the kubeconfig. So in this case, I say to them, okay, please vCluster connect. In this case, I use this to get the kubeconfig. You could have an automatic system because the kubeconfig is saved here in the secret. So what you could do now is also in terms of your pipeline process is just to send, for example, the kubeconfig via mail to the team, for example, or you provide it via your means. Maybe you have to encrypt or whatever. So this is also depending on the company. We get, for example, for our on-premise cluster, we get the kubeconfig via encrypted mail from the operation colleagues. So it again depends on you. Here, to speed up the story, I use I export it here in the kubeconfig file. Let us go into the kubeconfig file. We see here team 3, that's a normal kubeconfig, and now we say export kubeconfig. So now we can say car-get nodes, and we see ta-da, that's our cluster, 111 seconds. That's the cluster we are at the moment. So this is now a Kubernetes cluster. We can say car-get ns. we see our namespaces. This is like a vanilla Kubernetes cluster. Now we can say kubectl run. And I want just want to run now an Nginx pod just to show you that it's working. So I just applied now my kubectl Nginx. You see here, Nginx gets instantly scheduled. That's really nice. And then we see again name and then the namespace and all the stuff. That's completely fine. So let us go now with K9s. We see, and here is our, this is our cluster view again. We see everything is working. And we see here the kube system. So as a normal Kubernetes cluster. And let me forward now to Nginx. So I created now a port forwarding just to test. I mean, I could now install here also ingress and everything. That's up to the team. And now let us see. And that our Nginx is up and running inside a virtual cluster. I have the feeling it's like a normal cluster. So if I, for example, delete the pod again, the port forwarding is also not working anymore. And now I can work. I can deploy as I wish. And I created now instantly a cluster. I just needed to have this approval process or this automated process, what you want. Everything is declarative in my code base. So here I can see now, okay, somebody, here's my webshop backend, here's my team three. I can see some informations. And if I want to change something, I can change it. And my GitOps engine is automatically reconciling the application. Okay, so far the demonstration. I hope you enjoyed it and it was not a little bit too much, but just to recap the situation. So you see, we completely, we created a bootstrap cluster. Let me go to Excalidraw. So we created our bootstrap script. The bootstrap script or the pipelines took care to spawn the infrastructure underneath to create a minimum backend to start the story. We applied also the base foundation of the applications we want to have. Everything is also in a GitOps, in Argo CD. Argo CD itself gets managed by Argo CD. Then when the application gets all deployed, we are good to go to start to deploy our actual clusters. And this is then the part what Argo CD is doing internally. And that's it. So that's quite neat and completely automated. And yes, of course, I mean, you can now come up with alerting, you can up with quota rules and all this kind of stuff. I mean, the whole day two operations part, which is also very, very important. You could come with pod placement. You could say, okay, we want some of the things need a specific setting or they need a different node. We could also split the stuff in different worker pools. I mean, this is all now Kubernetes stuff. So if you know pod placements, you can now work with pod placements. Okay. Yep. So. Okay.
So my camera isn't working. Don't know why. So, but thank you very much, Engin. It's been a wonderful session. Like, you've done a wonderful points of actually how we want to use the virtual cluster. That is actually a most exciting part. Today's the whole story is how we actually use a virtual cluster. So I think the way you draw a point, that's a real use cases for the real world scenarios. That's most exciting for me. Like, yeah, you spun up the virtual cluster and do some Argo CD, Argo workflow. That's really inspired me in the power of the virtual cluster and actually how do we use it. I think how much thing I learned from 1 hour is, I think the list of the achievable is so long. So thanks very much for a wonderful session and the wonderful deep dive on how actually we use it, because I use a virtual cluster for the learning purposes. Like somebody hop into the team, how do we able to jump that? How we be able to help the team developer in speed up their learning process? So that's actually the one way. But the way you showed it, actually, this is actually the power of the virtual cluster. You spun up doing the GitOps things, enable everything you have. So that's really inspires me for the whole journey. So thank you very much. So as we have more questions, so we will hop into it. I think we will join you again in the future as well on this GitOps and these kind of stuff is. But I think this shows actually the virtual cluster, the neatness, the easiness, the learning curve. There's no much behind there. And also, if you want to test out like some of the things, you can't test out on the live cluster. You spun it up with the virtual cluster as well. Like you demo on the IT, you create some virtual cluster, test it, try it out. How do you do it? You can do it. All these kind of stuff is that another neat cleanies. But the way you throw the points on the how you use it, this really inspired it. I definitely go about after switching after this session, learn these particular use cases as well. Haven't implemented it, but it's so easy, so nice. And it's actually the real use case of the virtual cluster. Yeah. So just Clive, before I let you go, just holify the process of how you see how the next steps are if people are learning virtual cluster from day one.
I mean, that's as you said, it's completely right. I mean, it's really, as you see, it's easy to spin up this stuff. And if I can do it, you can do it even better. I'm completely believe in this. And now you can say, if I have the kube config automatically provided to me, it's now up to me. I can come up. I can use Flux inside my, I don't need to use Argo. I could use now Flux inside my virtual cluster to install all my stuff. I could use my own Prometheus inside, because the customer or my teams, maybe they don't even know it. That's a virtual cluster. For them, it's just a Kubernetes cluster. It's an API endpoint. And that's the beauty now. And now you have all the possibilities you can try. I can use virtual cluster now to test my new deployment, maybe an update. I want to update my whole cluster structure. I could use virtual cluster. I'm not sure if you can use virtual cluster in a virtual cluster. That could be interesting to see. But so from here, it's up to you. And I really
yes,
also
absolutely,
enjoy
absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, absolutely, absolutely. I think Rich Burrows has a video on his channel, like nested virtual cluster. If you hop into the channel, but I think I really learned so many good things. Like this is actually the I'm looking forward to you. Actually, how you implement the CI/CD pipelining, the cluster, or these kind of stuff. Actually, how we can use it. That this show actually the power of how you actually automate all of these things from the Argo CD and spun up a new cluster. It's watching the changing, reconciling the reconciliation, diff detection. These kind of stuff. So I think thank you very much for the wonderful complete hands-on session for thank the you. audience. I think everybody who joined us today really enjoy it, and people who enjoy this later will learn so many cool stuff from it. But thank you very much, Engin, for joining us today. It's really our first webinar with you. We hope to continue our collaboration with you in the future as well. So thanks everyone who joined us for today's webinar. We'll join you again later as the year progresses. Bye bye everyone. Stay safe and stay healthy. Bye-bye.
Bye bye.